Today marks 2 months since a gunman opened fire on a bowling alley and bar in Lewiston, Maine, killing 18 people and injuring 13 others. It was the country's deadliest mass shooting this year, and one community was hit especially hard. The shooting is believed to be the deadliest for deaf people ever in the U.S. Laura Barrón-López looks at how the deaf community in Maine is rebuilding in the wake of tragedy and how the community there is coping with this holiday season.
Our wedding day, our celebration.
Megan and Stephen Vizella were married on November 12th of last year.
You know, he always told me he loved me every day. It didn't matter if we were having an argument or what. He said he loved me. He'd give me a kiss goodnight.
But just weeks before what would have been their first wedding anniversary, Stephen was killed by a gunman at Schmengi's Bar and Grill along with seven others.
They said Steve got shot. And I shut down. I was gone. I can't describe any more than that. That suit was...
Megan says he was a devoted father who loved traveling, camping, and cornhole. He died playing with his cornhole team.
That's what he was doing Wednesday nights. You know, sometimes a lot of deaf people were there at the cornhole tournament just to get together and enjoy time together.
That Wednesday night of October 25th, Stephen was one of four deaf people killed. Stephen Vizella, Joshua Seal, Billy Brackett, and Brian McFarlane. A loss felt acutely throughout Maine's small and tight-knit deaf community.
Our friends, you know, and our husbands who are gone with him, it's not easy. My friend Liz, I mean, we grew up together, and Josh Seal, I grew up with him. I mean, it's too difficult to talk about. You know, to where both lost our husbands.
Kyle Curtis was Stephen's best friend and cornhole partner. He was at the bar that night and was shot in the arm.
My mind was racing with where are my friends and what has happened. I mean, it was a tragic night. It's the worst night I've ever had in my life, and there's nothing that can compare to that.
What has your recovery been like?
Seeing that we have one another and the support has been very strong, that has helped to be able to get some healing and processing. So the process has been slow. I know it will take more time, but it is a wonderful, connected family.
Richard Morlock, another survivor, also recalled the shock he felt that night. He didn't realize what was happening until he saw the shooter.
There was this loud boom, and then it continued. There was a second and third strange sound. And after that, I don't know how many more after that, we saw the man start shooting. I was essentially in a corner, so I went to the ground. I dropped and played dead, I mean, and just laid there and tried to just wait it out.
Morlock, Curtis, and a few other survivors from that night often gather at Sliders just down the road. Morlock says he is grateful to have a place to get together and enjoy the game they all love.
We cannot give up or let this stop us. We need to stay strong and support one another. You know, it allows us to have fun. If we didn't have this, I think it would be very difficult.
Do you feel as though the deaf community has had enough resources to recover from the mass shooting?
So far, I feel like they've had support, but it's going to be a long process to be able to heal. There's going to be counseling that's needed and all of that, so I know they have a long way to go. You know, we can't have any of these resources end.
The deaf people who survived the shooting here at Schmengi's are still trying to rebuild a sense of community. They hope their experience brings attention to needed resources for deaf people everywhere.
What took place in Maine is just illustrative, one isolated example. What can go wrong anywhere in this country?
Howard Rosenblum is CEO of the National Association of the Deaf. He says the shooting in Lewiston highlighted systemic issues that leave deaf people more vulnerable during and after traumatic events.
There was no way to access whatever services were being provided. The deaf and hard of hearing community, historically, have thought long and hard about how we get warnings and information. And often we are at the end of the communication loop and we are the last to know. Indeed, in the Lewiston shooting, this is another demonstration of the problem rooted in the system itself.
Rosenblum says deaf people are also forgotten in the aftermath of a disaster. In Lewiston, interpreters were left out of the initial press briefings and kept out of hospitals in the hours after the shooting.
The community has been hard at work with law enforcement, clinical hospital staff, governor's offices, to get changes moving. And I remain ever hopeful that even though it's a terrible tragedy, what happened in Maine, that it will lead to better system-wide changes.
We're working on it right now. We are really struggling with accessibility, for sure.
Megan Vizella hopes the deaths of her husband and his friends can bring about life-saving changes for deaf people in times of crisis.
There's nothing we can do about this situation that happened that night. They're just going to have to fix the system. We don't need to lay blame, but we need to work together and really work to improve it. We need to move on from here.
But moving on is difficult, especially this time of year. With photos of Stephen everywhere, Megan holds on tight to memories with her husband.
He was always asking me to make the cookies every Christmas.
What are holidays like now that it's the first year without him?
It's been hard. It's the first time setting up the Christmas tree, the one behind me. That's a new one. It was a wedding gift. And I struggled with that. My daughter didn't want to help with it. She didn't really want to have anything to do with it. So I did it alone. Very hard because Steve was always there every year. He loved the Christmas tree and decorating. So this year, it's not the same at all.
For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Laura Barrón-López in Maine.